there. My name is Ken Munro. I'm a security researcher. I have a team of amazing researchers that work alongside me that look at the cybersecurity of airplane systems. Now, one of the things you probably saw this morning when Sean from Boeing gave an amazing talk, airplanes are safe. It's very difficult to affect the cybersecurity of an airplane. But one of the things that we want to look at are systems that feed data into planes, systems that pilots use, and some of the things that you can do with them. Obviously, there's a disclaimer in this talk. There's also a little bit of a disclaimer from me, which is about responsible disclosure. When we find vulnerabilities in aviation systems, we disclose them privately to the organization. We disclose them privately to the vendor so they can take action. But it takes a long time to fix aviation systems. It can take a couple of years just to fix some code. So don't expect to go dropping O-days on 90 days. It takes time to fix aviation systems. Be responsible, disclose responsibly. So, number one, what on earth is an electronic flight bag? Well, in the past, it was literally a bag. I'm a pilot, I'm a general aviation pilot, and I would carry around my charts, my maps, and my manuals in a bag. But they need to be updated. It's really important that all the information that you carry as a pilot is kept current. When a runway changes, when a NOTAM with some engineering works maybe changes the available length of a runway, you need to know. So for reasons of efficiency, also saving weight, so 30, 40, 50 pounds of printed paper, we use electronic flight bags nowadays. Typically, an EFB is an iPad, a portable EFB, an iPad, maybe an Android tablet, perhaps a Windows computer, maybe a ruggedized PC. Now, those EFBs often go home with the pilot. They take them home so that they can check their roster, prepare for the next flight, take it into the cockpit with them next time they go, hook up, off we go. But they must be updated. Legally, they must be updated at least every 30 days to reflect changes. What does an EFB do? Well, EFBs are fascinating. One of the primary uses of an EFB is performance, which we usually abbreviate to PERF. What is performance? Well, it's about calculating how much power, how much thrust you're going to need from the engine. It might surprise you to know that airplanes very rarely used full power. Well, why? Well, it's efficient. Why burn loads of fuel, costing you lots of money, pumping out lots of carbon dioxide, making a lot of noise, but most importantly, adding extra wear to the engine? So we do a calculation to work out how much power we need to take off safely, but efficiently. And there are lots of bits of information that go into that calculation. So a really important one is the wind direction. Is it strong? Is it blowing down the runway? What's the temperature? What's the pressure, the air pressure outside? How high are you above sea level? How long is the runway? And what's the configuration of the plane? Really important. And those, all that data gets gathered together, and the EFB will do a calculation and tell you how much power, how much thrust you're going to use. In Airbus planes, that's typically known as the flex temp, or FLX. So that is a D-rate calculation. With Boeing planes, it's typically called D-rate. You also get, on top of the amount of power you need, your V-speeds. So V1, that's the speed at which you can safely stop the airplane on the runway by applying the brakes. VR, that's your rotation speed, so that's when the pilot goes, pulls back. And then V2, which is the point at which the airplane can safely climb away. Now, that gap between V1 and V2 is quite scary, because if something goes wrong, you're probably going off the end of the runway. So, already, mistakes happen. EFBs make things safer. They make things more efficient. But sometimes, and you can go and look at accident investigation reports on the internet, you can download them and read them. And quite often, you'll see, for example, miskeyings, where the pilot has taken the wrong information and put it into the flight management system. That's the cockpit display unit, the CDU, or MCDU in Airbus terms. Things go wrong. Despite pilots cross-checking, occasionally tired pilots, overworked pilots, distracted pilots, sometimes put the wrong data in. And a really good example of that was a series of incidents that happened at Lisbon Airport in Portugal. You can go and read them if you like. And what was happening is there was confusing information being served to the pilot. So this is satellite view of Lisbon Airport. And this one example illustrates what happens when you get the data wrong. So if you look at the taxiways up here, one of those taxiways is called taxiway S. And typically smaller airplanes, so 737s, A320s, will start at a displaced threshold. They'll start their takeoff roll pretty much kind of in the middle third of the runway. The heavies, so the Airbus A380, 747 for example, need a bit more, so they go to the end. But in order to get the performance calculation right, you need to choose the correct runway intersection. And that pops up in your EFB and you go, right, I want to go to intersection S. Now what had happened is the naming convention for some of the intersection points in Lisbon Airport was a little unusual. And there was also some work going on which resulted in temporary intersections being placed. So what happened is on a number of occasions, pilots were confused, chose the wrong intersection, and then the FB thought they had the whole of the runway, 4,000 meters of runway, but actually they were taking off halfway down. And there's been lots of cases where the aircraft climbed away, didn't crash, which is great. Skilled pilots know what to do. But flight safety was compromised. Now, in fairness, this has been investigated, and actually Lisbon Airport has renamed their intersection points to make them much less confusing. And actually, these issues have started to go away. But you can see how this could have started a cascade of events. Other crazy things that go on. If you try to rotate at too low an airspeed, one of the most likely consequences is what's called a tail strike. So when the pilot rotates, they expect the plane to climb away. If they continue to rotate but there's not enough thrust, it's quite likely you'll hit the tail. This was a particularly nasty incident, actually ripped off part of the tail cone. But you can go and read up about instances where this just happens. In this particular incident, the pilots tried to rotate at nearly 40 knots slower than they should have done. So unsurprisingly, the plane sat on its tail, but they did get away. The plane didn't pressurize correctly, and all the masts came out, and the pilots safely returned. But it could have been quite a bit worse. An example of where things can go really badly wrong. This is MK Airlines Flight 1602. You can go and read up about it if you like. You can read the incident reports. You can go and find out about it on Wikipedia. They used an electronic flight bag to calculate the performance they required. But the pilots were quite tired. They'd worked long into the night. And they didn't account for the additional freight they'd put on board and the additional fuel that was uploaded. So the calculations they did were with far too low a weight calculation. So the EFB recommended a much lower thrust setting, which would have taken away at the lower weight. But of course, they were much, much heavier. And actually what happened is the plane never really made it into the air. And very sadly, the plane crashed, caught fire, and everyone on board was killed, which is horrific. That's what can go wrong with electronic flight bags. There's also another aspect of PERF. So we talk about landing performance as well. Now, typically, landing incidents tend to be a result of difficult conditions, wind shear, for example, and also pilot mishandling. This is an example. This was an overrun, a runway excursion is the term we use. And the pilots in this case hadn't selected the correct auto brake. They'd chosen an auto brake setting for a complicated and challenging approach. If they'd used a harder brake setting, the plane would have stopped. They had difficulty handling the approach. They landed, the brakes weren't applied as much as they should have done, and the plane sadly slid off the end of the runway. This could have easily been resolved by taking a stronger braking mechanism. We're not quite sure why they chose not to use as much braking. But we've also shown, if you can start miskeying, you start to see the plane, assuming it's got more runway than it should have, so the electronic flight bag might recommend the wrong brake setting itself. So where am I going with this? Well, the other big area we see is weight and balance. A plane cannot take off without its weights and balance being inside a particular envelope. And there's a good example here. This is an incident that happened a little while back. What had happened is the airplane type was changed, but the EFB hadn't picked up that it changed from an Airbus A320 to an A321, which has got a completely different load sheet. It's longer, but the passengers were loaded towards the front because the A320 is shorter. You can go and read up if you like. And you can see that's the load sheet, and you see the red dots on the left there. They show that the actual loading of the plane was outside of the performance envelope for the plane. What happened? The pilot got to VR. He tried to rotate. The nose wheel didn't lift. But he was a very well-trained pilot. He responded correctly. He gave it a lot of extra power, gave takeoff go-around power, full thrust, toga, and the additional moment from the engine slung beneath the wind with the wing correctly then lifted the nose off. And there was no further incident. But imagine if that pilot hadn't responded correctly. This could have been quite nasty. So let's look at hacking electronic flight bags. What I've talked about so far are some of the things that go wrong when pilots maybe misunderstand, misinterpret, or do the wrong thing. It's not about mis-entry or mistransposing or miskeying. You can address those with good standard operating procedures, or SOP, which every airline operator has and sticks by. What we've been intrigued by was the opportunity instead to tamper with the calculations themselves. We found security vulnerabilities in electronic flight bags that would allow you to do that. Another really common problem we find, and this will, the reason I'm talking about this will become clear in a moment, is that electronic flight bag, that iPad, that Android tablet, that Windows PC, we find numerous cases where the device lockdown is pretty weak. We found tablets with no pin at all, or with a really simple pin, 1111, 1234, or the first four digits of the pilot's birthday, which you can find easily online. Or no device lock at all, or no lockdown, no mobile device management platform, are way out of date with critical updates. We also see challenges between ground IT ops going, hey, we know how to do that, we can lock down that iPad and make it really safe and secure. And that's when you really need to think and talk to your crews about how they use these devices. If you do a standard corporate device build, you're gonna cause problems. And a great example of this would be, well, one solution, maybe with iOS, would be to implement Face ID. Great, that'll solve a problem, won't it? The pilot can just look at it and unlock it. Except pilots like wearing sunglasses, which can make Face ID really challenging. And if you're dealing with an emergency, maybe there's a rapid depressurization. Now, you'll deal with the incident using the quick reference handbook. You'll probably do it from memory first, but then you'll consult with your flight bag, which contains the electronic quick reference handbook, to make sure that you've correctly handled the incident. So imagine trying to unlock your iPad when you've got a face mask on. This is not good. So we need to really think carefully about how we lock these devices down. But the problem we have now is we see so often that they aren't locked down at all. And that leads to all sorts of problems. So I'm going to talk about some vulnerabilities that we found in electronic flight bags. Although the majority of these are going to be anonymous because they are still going through the disclosure process. But an example, one electronic flight bag package which contained a suite of applications, so performance, perf, weight and balance, and others. We looked at this and quite shocked to discover that an iOS app this was, so again, certificate validation is enforced by default, had been switched off. Now, that means that you can man the middle, which means you can send rogue data as part of the update process. This had been consciously done by the EFB software vendor. We're not sure why, but they had disabled a really important security feature of the EFB. So how would you actually go about exploiting that? Well, you need the system to communicate, you want to grab an update. Well, actually, it's not so difficult because pilots tend to use the same layover hotels when they're down route. They always stay in the same places. They tweet about it. They put it on Prune, the pilot's network. And they have to update those devices at least once a month. So you know where the hotel is. You know where the pilots stay. You'll know they're going to do an update. You man in the middle. Now you can change data. What did we discover looking at one app? We discovered that we could recover the credentials, even though they were unique per EFB. We could recover the API keys. We noticed they didn't correctly hash the password. We could intercept the database. We could trash the database so the EFB didn't work. But given time, once we'd figured out the CRC, we could actually put wrong data into that EFB. Now, obviously, we need to have build issues, but also software problems. Now, going through disclosure, actually, that's quite challenging. Cross-checks are great, because if one EFB disagrees with the other one, so the pilot and the co-pilot get different data, you'd know something had gone wrong. But you attack them both because they're both staying in the same layer of a hotel and both updating at the same time. This was a real shock because this was a big EFB package used by hundreds of airlines. And this wasn't a complicated vulnerability to find. So we assume we were probably the very first organization to ever pen test this. And I have to say that the disclosure experience, I think, showed a disconnect between understandings at the software vendor and the operator. So the software vendor thought that actually every single time a plane took off and an EFB calculation was done, they'd do it on two separate EFBs. That's not the way that most airlines work. Typically, one pilot will put the data in, pass it to the other pilot to verify, press calculate, and get the performance package back. That's not what they thought. And we were very shocked when we disclosed the vulnerability to them. We pushed and pushed. And finally, they came back and said, yeah, if we fix that, we think that's a product improvement. So we don't need to do that, which I found really shocking. I'm going to talk about a real vulnerability now. I'm going to name some names. This is a product we looked at 2 years ago. We tried to disclose responsibly. We had assistance from the aviation industry. They helped us try to disclose. And the vendor involved still didn't respond. And we agreed a few months ago with industry groups that we'd disclose this publicly. So we did not disclose this irresponsibly. It was quite a shock, actually, the degree of lack of device build and hardening. Now, it does the usual things we'd expect. So it does weight and balance, performance, etc. It was a portable electronic flight bag, but unusually, it was lock-wired in place in the cockpit and also networked in. And both EFBs were networked to each other, which was quite interesting. They tried to do some lockdown, so you had an admin mode and you needed a password to get into it. But unfortunately, it was trivially easy to break out. Control, shift, escape, you use task manager and kill the application. Great, and now you're into the underlying operating system. Good old bit of Windows. Credentials, so you needed the password to get into admin mode to do anything, and it was password. Great. They were networked together, which meant you could actually compromise one from the other. And that then defeated the value of a cross-check between the pilots. You could compromise them both concurrently. You compromise all the data there. And we often see this. They'll put stickers over USB ports saying, don't use it. But it was still live. And we realized using something like a Bash Bunny, we'd need physical access for a few seconds, and you'd have an attack. But this was effectively lock-wired in place in the cockpit. So do not overlook. There's a big physical security challenge in getting into the plane and getting access to the cockpit. But I still think we need to see this fixed. One area that was really interesting is we'd read the manuals for this device, and it supports Wi-Fi. And the manuals would suggest that Wi-Fi was typically enabled in the standard build. But we didn't find the Wi-Fi connection on the tests we did. Had there been Wi-Fi active, this device hadn't been updated for 7 years or more. There are exploitable vulnerabilities, which effectively gave you a potential for a remote attack, so you would no longer need physical access. That, I think, was a surprise. But whose responsibility is it? Well, I think it's a bit of both. I think the manufacturer of this device probably needs to give more detail, more support, ensure that a device is locked down well. But also the operator, the airline, has responsibility for keeping it up to date as well. They update it with software updates for the navigational database every 30 days, but no one had ever applied an operating system update to it, good we could see. We've got plenty of advice on our website about how we think you could practically harden electronic flight bags. It's not that hard. Another one, I'm not gonna name this one. This was a surprise. Plain text database with no integrity checks on the data in the database itself, which made it trivially easy to tamper with data. Do you remember I talked about runway overruns? Well, if I tell the EFB that the runway is longer than it thinks it is, it's gonna give incorrect performance data and potentially the plane will tail strike, not take off, or maybe have a runway excursion. It was plain text data and there was no attempt to validate the integrity of it at all. I would add, obviously, you do need to have a weak device lockdown on the BFB itself, but now you've got a chain. Weak device build, like we've talked about, and also a vulnerability you can exploit to tamper with the data. Another one. This one was quite interesting. They'd actually gone to some trouble to try and validate the integrity of the data. They'd used cryptographic validation, which was good, but the AES keys were hard-coded in the app. And the keys were 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 0. So it was a weak key. It was an accessible key. So that meant you could then defeat the lockdown. You could defeat the integrity checks. And you could then tamper with data again, resulting in these things we've talked about. Other things we've found over the years. Every single EFB package we've ever tested so far has had mostly trivial vulnerabilities that would allow compromise. We've looked at six of them, covering almost every major operator. And the disclosure we've experienced has been amazing on one hand, had a fantastic experience of a really responsible software vendor that took the vulnerability and acted on it. And they independently updated us once a month to say what we're doing, how long it's going to take. Fantastic. That is how it should be. To the other extreme, where we were told it was a product improvement, or they just didn't even reply to us. It's like, we're giving you safety-related data for free. Other things that can go wrong. Now, we talk in the industry about controlled flight into terrain. That's the worst possible situation, where an airplane that's perfectly serviceable flies into the ground, usually in bad weather. So some examples we've shown, other things you can tamper with using the vulnerabilities that we've shown. This is an approach plate. So the way this is worked, so the plane arrives at 5,000 feet. Typically, you'll find this on a non-precision approach, so somewhere where there isn't an instrument landing system. But bear in mind, a lot of ILSs are being retired at the moment because they're expensive to maintain, and there are other ways of arriving. You might see a DME VOR-coupled approach in this example. So you bring your airplane in at 5,000 feet. That's 14 miles, so D14, from the VOR, BRA. That's your initial fix, IF. You then get to the top of the descent, D, and then you approach on a 170-degree bearing, and you're allowed to, you can descend until you get to the final approach fix, F, MDA, minimum descent altitude, and then you hit the runway or the middle marker, at which point you go around if you're not stable on approach. Well, we showed it was trivially easy to change the descent altitudes. So the pilot thinks it's safe to descend lower than they thought, and the result is control flight into terrain. A consequence of hacking electronic flight bag. Another one, this one scared me actually. Around the world, there are a number of air defense identification zones. A good example of that might be if you want to fly in or near to Tehran in Iran, is you have to follow a very specific procedure. You have to check in by radio. You have to be identified by Tehran control. And once they've done that, that's fine. But you can tamper with the data that explains that in the electronic flight bag and remove it, which means you've got potential for a defense-based reaction or potentially even being shot down, which I hope never happens, although you might remember there was an incident many, many years ago where a plane was intercepted, a passenger plane, and was shot down. It's quite scary, isn't it? I do think it's really important to talk about balance here, though. It concerns me greatly. People talk about hacking airplanes, but actually balance is very, very important. If a pilot is presented with misleading data, is well-trained and following standard operating procedure, they'll detect and respond to that, as you've seen numerous cases of near incidents which the pilots have responded to correctly because they were well-trained and responsible, safe pilots. But if you start tampering with the data they're receiving, it increases the chance of a cascade of events starting. Planes don't just fall out of the sky. A series of things typically happen. But we have a strong belief that an electronic flight bag is a safety-critical device. We believe it should be treated as such by regulators and operators. And I was very shocked when speaking to the chief pilot of a large airline to discover that he'd actually given his EFB to his kid the last time they went to the airport to fly, and the kid was using it to watch Netflix. That's mind-blowing, right? A safety-critical device. Regulation does exist, and the regulatory frameworks around the world do differ. EFBs, portable EFBs, not installed ones, portable ones, fall into something of a gray area in some jurisdictions. Not all, in some. In some cases, there's simply guidance for operators about how the regulator feels or believes that the EFBs should be secured, but no regulation forcing it to happen. We've seen in some regulatory authorities, we've seen holes. And one vendor we tried to disclose to responded us and used a gap in that regulation to sidestep fixing it. We're also surprised, as I mentioned, to see some large airlines encouraging the pilots to use the EFB as a personal device too. And my overwhelming message is I feel that EFB security is treated far too much as a nice to have rather than something that should be absolutely mandatory and enforced. I want to leave you with a couple of final thoughts though. Is currently a portable EFB is separate from the airplane systems. It's maybe an iPad or an Android tablet. And it doesn't ever connect to the airplane systems. So the data has to be transposed, copied, which sometimes lead to mistransposal problems. But as we start to see these electronic flight bags evolve and start to connect to flight deck systems, and there is an ARINC standard out there already, ARINC 834, which talks about the aircraft data interface function, which is a simple text protocol. It's a well-written protocol. It's a good protocol. But if the vulnerability is in the electronic flight bag itself, we have challenges. And the future is here already. The Airbus A350 already has electronic flight bag integration with the flight deck. And there's a great photograph. You see the two screens on the outside of the cockpit there? You've got the multifunction displays in the middle. And those outer screens actually take and consume data from the electronic flight bag and display it in a more convenient fashion. It's a really, really nice feature. It's the future. But if the electronic flight bag itself isn't sufficiently hardened and kept up to date, we're now starting to create interesting potential vectors. So in conclusion, I believe electronic flight bags absolutely need to be hardened, secured, updated, because if we don't, we risk threatening flight safety. And more than anything, to any pilot out there, should you be watching Netflix on your EFB? Probably not. Thank you. So we do have time for questions if anyone would like to pop up and ask at the microphone. No questions. If anyone would like to ask questions privately, I'll be down here. Oh, I think we might have a question.
You talked about Wi-Fi. Have you ever seen an EFB with cellular also? I mean, LTE, for instance?
Yes, so the question was, as we talked about Wi-Fi, have we seen electronic flight bags with cellular access? Yes, absolutely. And you often find that, and it's probably a roaming SIM, so the pilot can easily update. So you do see cellular connectivity, but obviously it's expensive. So if the pilot can update over Wi-Fi, that's a lot cheaper for the operator, right? Great question. Another question.
First off, I have to fly home at the end of the week, so thanks for that. But with this being so important, why are they even portable anymore at all? Why are they not just built into the aircraft?
That's a really great question. So if the security is so important for these devices, why are pilots allowed to take them home with them? Well, actually, the first electronic flight bags, and many now, are installed. So that's actually one on the Boeing stand. They brought one along, a demonstration example of a fully integrated, installed EFB. And they're great, but pilots often want flexibility. So maybe they want to check their roster. Maybe they want to do some flight planning at home beforehand. And actually, I think you'd argue that it's probably more efficient to have a portable electronic flight bag, but maybe not so efficient if someone's been watching Netflix on it. Do we have any further questions? I think there's one more.
Is there any data that indicates that any of these vulnerabilities have been exploited actively in the past?
No, I'm probably the wrong person to ask. I think the only organizations that have access to that type of data are probably the airlines themselves. And I cannot imagine they would want to publicize that they'd had security failings or incidents on their electronic flight bags. You know, flying is safe. Flying is secure. You know, what we don't need to do is destabilize the traveling public now that we're all traveling again. But I do think that we need to take this seriously. I haven't seen any evidence just they've been exploited. Hopefully, operators will now lock down their flight bags. Manufacturers will now think more seriously about the security of their software apps. And we won't have any such cases. But let's hope.
Curious if you've seen this in large aircraft operators. Small aircraft operators and some military aircraft are now starting to incorporate the EFB as a primary flight display, so it physically clips onto the dashboard. Are larger operators also considering doing that?
Yeah, so the question was, so some smaller operators would typically use the EFB as a primary flight display. So in the image I showed a little earlier, you saw the artificial horizon and the performance data from the engines. So in smaller airplanes and very small operators, they might actually upgrade the old steam-powered instruments we talk about, so the old dials, and actually have the EFB as a smart aircraft interface. That definitely happens in smaller operators. I can't see it happening in larger certified environments, certainly in the near future anyway. Great, thank you so much. I'll be over in the Aerospace Village if you have any questions afterwards. Thank you.